good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. And a special day that we start our local party here at Sabadell. So at least we have few people. And just before we start the seminar, I want to say that for the best question after the seminar, we will have a gift. We can just share this the Swiss chocolate that Jeff bring to all of us here after the seminar. So it's a pleasure to see you here. So Jeffrey Jackwell is coming from the University of Manchester. He's a specialist in the chemical ecology research area. He has worked with many different organisms, and nematode, now is with mosquito, slug, all kinds of different organisms, and how is all the chemical ecology related with all the interaction. Jeff did his master studies in the University of Busan. And later after, he did the PhD at the University of Manchester with Jeff Tarlins and me as co-supervisor. Today, he's going to present one of his projects as postdoc there as at the University of Manchester. And hopefully, you enjoy about this exciting result about the two repellent products emitted by the nematode effect. So thank you, Jeff, for coming, and thank you for listening.
Welcome. thanks, not yet, I didn't say anything. Okay, thank you, Raquel, for the introduction. So as Raquel said, I'm working at the University of Neuchâtel, and maybe you don't know where is Neuchâtel. It's a small city in Switzerland. Switzerland is a small country, so usually people don't know much about Switzerland. But yeah, Switzerland is this country next to France, Italy, Liechtenstein, and Germany. And it's a small city which is very nice to live too, because it's around a lake, kind of a big lake, and it's a very beautiful city. We actually have, the best view on the Alps. We can see almost all the Alps from the city, from all around the city. And we have a very nice university there. It's a small university, but yeah, it's very nice to work there. And as Raquel said, she was there, and Ruben as well, for some years, and we did some work together. So the one I highlighted are the one that were part of the project that Raquel was supervising mainly, and Ted was just paying. Okay, so as I said, this project was a national research project, and it was called the Sustainable Use of Soil as a Resource. And we did many research about nematodes and the interaction of nematodes with their environment, let's say. And we did a lot of survey where we were going to the field and pick up some sample and extract the nematodes from the soil and do some qPCR to count those nematodes. So I spend a lot of time in the lab with Ruben, mainly. But it was very nice to work with him, and that's why I'm here today again. And now I will start with the real introduction. So I will talk about entomopathogenic nematodes, and those nematodes, they are obligate parasites of insects, and they mainly, they usually prefer, let's say, the larvae stage of the insects, because they are easier to penetrate. And so those nematodes, they live freely in the soil. And when they encounter a larvae, for instance, this larvae, they will penetrate the insect. So once inside, the nematodes, they carry bacteria. They are symbionts. This is a mutualistic relationship, so they both need each other. And once inside the larvae, they will release this bacteria, and this bacteria will multiply and create a septicemia inside the larvae. So after that, the nematodes, they will go through a cycle inside where they will feed on the bacteria and all the remaining larvae that has been digested by the bacteria. And after some time, thousands and thousands of new nematodes will come out of this larvae, and then they will go back to the soil, and then the cycle will start again. So what is interesting is that there is almost as many species of bacteria that there is of species of nematodes. So the association is quite specific. It happens that some bacteria share the same nematodes or vice versa. But as I say, it's kind of very specific. And those bacteria, they are gram-negative, and they belong to the family of Heterobacteriaceae. Here you can see some pictures where you can find those bacteria in the nematodes, so they are in some special parts of the intestine. And this is a picture, for example, of one in those bacteria inside a nematode. So they are carried inside the nematodes. And what are the benefits for the nematodes from having those bacteria? So the bacteria, they help to protect the cadavers, so the insect cadaver, from competing nematodes. So it has been shown that it's the bacteria that is responsible for this protection, but also from other bacteria and fungus growth. So this is very interesting. So that it means that without the bacteria that it develops inside the cadaver will be not protected against those organisms, and then the nematodes and the bacteria will not develop correctly. And another interesting fact is that those cadavers are also protected from insect scavengers, such as ants, for instance, or flies. And it seems that it is the bacteria that is doing this job. So this protection, the one from insect cadavers, is the one I'm going to talk about today. It involves some products of repellent compounds that are produced by the bacteria. So when this guy wrote this in 2002, he didn't have really a good idea of what he was saying, but he was right. So it was more like a guess, but there is no really proof. Okay, what are the benefits for the bacteria? So these bacteria, they don't live in the soil freely, so they cannot persist in the soil by themselves. So that's why they need the nematodes to carry them from an insect to another. So without the nematodes, those bacteria, they will basically not exist. They will not live. So you have this very special relationship, and usually the heterorhabdite species of nematodes, they are associated with the photorhabdus species of bacteria. And the Sternenema species of nematodes, they are associated with the Xenorhabdus species of bacteria. And so, as I say, they are this complex of bacteria and nematodes, they are deterrents for the scavengers. And why? So why we need to deter those scavengers? Or other bacteria, or as I say before, fungus growth, or these kind of things, is because both the bacteria and the nematodes, they need to remain in the cadaver to complete their life cycle. So if the cadaver is infected by something else, or if it's opened by a scavenger insect, both of the organisms will die, the nematodes and the bacteria. So as I say, the infected cadavers are a deterrent to scavengers, and the scavengers, they avoid those nematodes infected cadavers. This I will show you from the study of those people before. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So the previous work that has been done on this topic, the first one that was really experimental, I'd say, was in 2002, and they show that the cadaver infected by nematodes were deterrent to ants, to just one species of ants. They just try one. And later on, so 10 years later, nobody looked into that for 10 years, this guy, Gulku, he showed that there were deterrents, but also to other scavengers. So for instance, here I put a picture. Here he applied directly the bacteria, and you can see that the flies, they will lay eggs on the control meat, but not on the one that where he applied the bacteria. And he did a very, very interesting experiment that I really like, because this is, to me, real science. You go outside. And so he has different larvae. Here you can see they were infected with different species of nematodes, actually two, Bacteophora and Feltiae. And they were infected for different time periods, so 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. And you have also some control larvae. And I will play the video. And okay, just put this outside and you wait for the ants to come. See, if you put food outside, in 10 minutes you have ants anyway. And you can see that the control larvae, or the ones that are just infected for not so long time, like just 2 days, they are really eaten by the ants, whether the other cadaver, like 3 years old, are really left untouched. It's very nice to see that by the end of the video, the control larvae disappeared. And you can see that the rest is remaining. So I really like this kind of experiment because, as I say, it's outside and it's like very realistic and it shows the point very well. Okay, so the aim of the research, it was mainly an idea of Raquel, was to determine whether what is the signal that is responsible for this deterrence. So why the ants, they don't like those larvae? And is it chemically triggered? Probably, but you know, never sure. And what are the compounds that are involved? Which is the most difficult question to answer. So most of the work, let's say, was done by a master's student, Shribala Durairaj, and that I was supervising at that time. So what we did is we did some extracts. So we extracted some Galeria melonella larvae that we infected with nematode, some that we freeze, and some that were alive. So this is two controls, and this is the treatment that we are interested in. And those larvae, they were just dipped into 400 microliters of hexane. And the control was just hexane only. So we chose this species, Tiernanema feltiae, and it's not like a random choice. It's because this nematode was shown to have the highest deterrent effect on the two different papers I mentioned before. So that's why we chose this species. Okay, then we set up a bioassay, and this bioassay was that we had the tested source here. It was just an Eperdoff tube lid that we put on the way up. And we put 12 Lasius niger ants. This is very, very common species of ants that you can find basically everywhere in Europe. And we had two type of measurements. We were looking whether the ants, they were touching the lid here that we call the FAR measurement, and whether they were inside feeding in the source, okay? And we videotaped that for 4 hours, and we measured the ant location every minute. So the tested source were the extract I mentioned before. So it was an extract for the nematode killed, the freeze killed, and alive larvae, and we add some honey and water to stimulate them to feed, okay? So this is how it looks when we videotaped, and here you can see, for instance, this was a control, and this was the nematode extract. So this is hexane only plus honey and water, and this is the nematode extract, the larvae, sorry, that was infected by nematode extract plus honey and water. And you can already see that they really don't like it. Okay, so that was the first test we done, was a two-choice test. We had 8 different colonies of ants. We replicate the whole stuff 2 times. And so the first was control plus honey water against the crude extract from freeze-killed larvae. So it's those two. Then we had control against the nematode-killed larvae. And then we had control against alive larvae extract. Okay, here are the results. So we can clearly see that the nematodes, they prefer the control to the nematode killed extract. And that was true for the, let's say, the close distance where they were really feeding inside, but also true from the far distance, or even though it was a bit less. Interestingly, I think this makes a lot of sense. They kind of prefer the extract of the alive larvae because for them it represents food, a potential source of food. So they definitely went for that. And when it was frozen, freeze-killed, it didn't make a lot of difference between the treatments, even though they slightly preferred the control, but it was very highly variable here. But from those results, we could already say that the nematode-killed extract, the nematode-killed larvae extract, sorry, was very potent, and that they really avoid that. So we wanted to confirm this, and it's like, let's say for statistics, if you do a fourth choice test, it increases the power of your data. So we put all the different extracts in the same plate, and we again add 8 different colonies, and we replicated the whole stuff 2 times. And we did find consistent results. So they really disliked the nematode-killed larvae extract as compared to the other ones. It was true from close and from far. So we were sure now that they really avoid the extract of the nematode killed larvae. So now the question is, can we know what are they avoiding? Is it by testing? It doesn't seem to be by testing because they also avoid it from distance. So it seems that it sees something in the air, so it should be chemical. So we did some gas chromatography analysis, and basically we run the same extract to the in the GC. And what we could see is that the nematode-killed extract had 2 compounds, those 2 compounds, hexadecanal and 2 heptadecanon, that were only present on those extracts, on the extract of the nematode-killed larvae, and not in the freeze-killed larvae and not for the alive larvae. So what we did is that those 2 compounds are commercially available, so I just bought them. And then I did the same experiment. So I did the 2 choice tests. I put the first compound, so which is hexadecanal, against the control. And we can clearly see as well that they avoided this when the food was baited with this compound. And it was true also for the far distance, the same that we found before. Then I tried the second compound, 2 heptadecanon. And this was also deterrent to the ends from the close distance, but not from the far distance. So obviously, what I did next is that I mixed the 2, and I see it, I try to see whether I increased the effect or not. So the same experiment, and I mixed the 2. And yes, I slightly increased the effect of the deterrence by mixing the 2, and also the fact that when you mix them both, they are also repelled from the far distance. Okay, so the conclusion and the discussion of this first part of the research was that we clearly saw an end deterrent activity of the compound that we identified, and it was more so in close proximity. So it worked better like when they are touching the food that really on the far distance. And there were a slightly enhanced effect when we mixed both compounds. And it was very interesting for us because this could be used as the deterrent against ants, and for example in houses or this kind of things, because those 2 products, they are not dangerous for human. And we actually filed a patent to with those 2 compounds to repel ants. But as all the researches, when you have answered some question, you have many more. And that was the perspective at that time. It was that we could test the compound against other scavengers and insects, because if they are repellent to ants, maybe they're repellent to other stuff. The experiments could be also done with only the bacteria by injecting the bacteria into the cadaver. So we remove the nematode's vector, let's say, and we just put the bacteria inside and see whether we can find the same results. The experiments could also be done with more nematode bacteria complex, because I used 1 species of nematodes, so 1 species of bacteria. But what happens if you use different species of nematodes and bacteria? And also, the experiment could be done with other hosts. So not Galeria melonella, but other insects. So after that, I did some of those experiments. So I will show the results of the experiments with more nematode bacteria complex. So here I use bacteriophora, so different species of nematodes, different species of bacteria. And, oh, sorry, this is a mistake. And I used Galeria melonella again, so I didn't change the host. And I could see those compounds, but they were very small as compared to when I used Feltiae instead of bacteriophora. And so it makes sense with the previous paper that said that the highest deterrent activity was observed for Feltiae and not for bacteriophora. So that was nice. Then I tried with another host, because Galeria melonella is very susceptible and to nematodes, and that's why we use Galeria melonella for this kind of experiment. But you have other insects that can be quite resistant to nematodes. And for instance, Tenebrio molitor, he has a very hard cuticula, and it's more difficult for the nematodes to get inside, and so they are more resistant. And what you see there is that you don't see the peaks anymore. So usually when you infect Tenebrio molitor with nematodes, you can see just some patches of nematodes, development of nematodes, but usually not in the whole cadaver. So it makes sense also that you don't see, because probably inside there is less nematodes, less bacteria, and so maybe we don't see the peaks. Maybe if we were more sensitive, we are the more sensitive machine, we could still see them. But so depending on the host, you may lose, let's say, the signal. Okay, what happens if you test the compounds against other scavengers and insects? And as I say, we already have filed the patent for the against ants, but it would be very interesting if we can repel more interesting insects like mosquitoes, ticks, or these kind of things. Ticks are not insects, but other organisms that are a problem for humans. So this is what we tried to do, because right now I'm working with mosquitoes and ticks. And we have this very nice setup that allows to test repellence to mosquitoes. Basically, this is a part that is heating, and it mimics the heat that you have on the human skin. You put mosquitoes inside, you apply the product here, and normally, just because it's warm, they will try to sting. And if they don't come to sting this plate that is warm, it means that the mosquitoes are repelled. So we tried our compounds. It was not super effective. So we had an effect, a very slight effect of both compounds. But as compared to other compounds that I used to work with that are very efficient, and let's say that at 10 milligram ml, you normally have zero landing of mosquitoes. They will not try to sting. Here, they still have a lot of landing, so it doesn't seem to deter much mosquitoes. So then I tried with ticks. We also have this very nice setup to see the repellence of ticks. So basically, this is a plate. It looks like this. There is four circles on the plate. And this is a plate that is heating as well. So we call it the warm plate assay, because this is warm. It's also 34 degrees, like the skin of a human. And basically, normally, if you put a tick in the middle of the circle, if they like it, they will go up. Because usually, when we get a tick, it's by walking into the grass, and then it's down there, and you will try to find the nice spots where it is wet usually, so behind the knees or this kind of place, so they will go up. And if they don't like a substance, they will go down, or they will even let them fall themselves, so they will fall off. So I tested the two compounds again with this setup, and we could clearly show that there were an effect. So this is the percentage of ticks that are affected, and with this compound we reach like 16% of the ticks that didn't like this compound. So this, again, it's not a super strong effect. We have compounds like 10 milligram ml, it's 100% of the ticks that are repelled. But still, we can see an effect, and we could also increase the dosage. So 10 milligram ml is not huge yet. We could put more. And the heptadecanone was also repellent at 10 milligram ml. So this is kind of promising, let's say, but we will not be able to really file any patents against mosquitoes and ticks because it's not strong enough, even though it's working. Okay, then, as I say, I tried other stuff, but this is one part that I didn't do yet, and it would be very nice to try again other scavengers, and mainly flies, for instance. Because if you could repel flies, this also could be interesting for the industry. And as I showed you before, when you applied only the bacteria, it's working very well. So maybe we could just apply those compounds and see in the same kind of assay if it's working as well. Yeah, I wanted to do that. We did that. So try to inject the bacteria into the cadaver. And so we had success in killing the cadaver and all, but we did not manage. We did not manage to find the pigs by doing only that. So maybe I don't know. I don't know if the nematode is necessary or if when we inject it's different than when the nematodes are infecting the larvae also. But yeah, I'm still trying to find out why, when we inject the bacteria right inside, we don't find those compounds again, which is kind of weird, but yeah, I'm working on that. Okay, I would like to thank Ted Turling. So this is our boss. He's running the lab. And Raquel, that had the idea of doing this research when she was in Neuchâtel. And of course, the master student that did a lot of the job. And on that, I would like to thank you for listening and to enjoy Las Fiestas de San Mateo, that I will also enjoy then.
So, can you grow this bacteria by isolating from the nematode? I understand.
Yes.
And is anything known about the specificity? What determines the specificity between the bacterial species and the nematode?
Why is it so specific?
Yeah.
Have like actinic nematodes, and then I put the because, for example, in one group, Sternonema, Feltea, Krause, and Affini hold the same Xenorhodus bovini. But looks like Sternonema, Feltea, this species is very promiscuous, could be holding Xenorhodus bovini of any other species. But for example, Krause need their own Xenorhodus bovini. You cannot put the bovini of other species. So there is. Depend on the species of the nematode that could be more generalist and is happy with whenever you put there or not. So it's something to very important when you are
yeah, this to investigate. And I think also sometimes you maybe have several bacteria, but like one is winning. You know, like one will definitely be the mutualistic bacteria, but could be sometimes others. No,
by both
or exactly.
It's funny because at early studies, like you say, Webster, the group, these French people and American one, they were writing a very nice chapter in 2002 that they were assuming that it was caused by the bacteria and blah, blah, blah. But then when you are doing the experiment, I mean, it was never proven and tested. And then when we were doing that, we were assuming that, of course, the bacteria will do this and that, but no, it looks like it needs an activation or something by the complex of the nematode and the bacteria. It's not just you put the bacteria and you run. You need both So there is some signal now, there is some group studying that. There is some signal that they say to the nematodes say to the bacteria that it's not killing the nematode. It's like, okay, now I'm going to release you and you can be active because you are in the right environment. So if you have the bacteria just in the plate, you don't have this kind of activation. So the bacteria can kill, but not in the same way that when they are together with
the nematodes. Yeah.
This is now the studies of Alder Dillman and these people in California. Mm-hmm. They are working on the activation phase of the nematode and bacteria.
So,
yeah. Yes.
Is it known the mechanisms by which these compounds are affecting the ants, or is the pheromone interacting with pheromone receptors, or?
No, so it's basically when it's repellent or deterrent, it means that it's a signal that they learned to recognize, let's say, as something bad. Okay, so it's because in this case, if the ants, they feed on one of these cadavers that is infected by nematodes, they will get infected as well. So it evolves that they avoid those cadavers. And so it evolved that they recognize this signal as something they need to avoid. But then the exact mechanism on which sensilla of the antenna it goes, this we don't know. No.
They will be infected by the bacteria, by the nematode?
By the nematode. Yeah.
No question? More curiosities?
Yeah, so this is one point, because it is, and I used to work with ants, so I had some experience, how to rear them and how to work with them, so yeah, it was easier for me, and also, yeah, this species is very common, it's very easy to go to the field to pick a queen and then to start a colony, and the other people in the papers, the first papers, they use ants, so I thought, okay, this is a good model, because I know it's working already. As I say, you've seen maybe if I used another host, like Tenebrio molitor and not Galeria melonella, I would have not found anything and you would have been disappointed. But sometimes when you know something is already working, you go for it.
Some more in the competition. So if no, we can just close and say thank you to Jeff, and we can share now all together.
Thank you. Thank you.